up. Daddy's girl, what about mommy? Yeah, her too. Yeah. Come on, guys. When we talk about ourselves, it can also sound like noisy gongs in God's ears. Like, you know, I like to sew, right? I like to make pretty pictures with fabric. But if I stood there and said, I am the best seamstress in the entire world, my works are lovely. Not such a nice sound, is it? No. But if I said, hi, I haven't seen you very often. I'm glad you came to church today. It would sound like this. So, remember, kiddos, your words have power. You can either sound like the noisy gong, or you can sound like the beautiful melody. It's up to you. Okay? So, let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you for this beautiful day and these beautiful children. We ask that as we go out this week, we consider whether our words sound like beautiful music or clanging gongs, and that we are mindful of what we do, and that we always look to you for guidance. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Glad you didn't find the real symbols in the back.
Oh, good.
No, I thought this would be, well, yeah. Plus, also, it woke you up a little bit, right? Yeah, everybody needs a little wake up. All right, guys.
Thank you, Miss Becky. Good lesson for all of us today, huh? It's like we're going to be making some music in the back. But I noticed that Miss Becky took her clanging cymbals back with her that direction, so they'll be grateful in the children's area.
Did you need me to send them with someone to the...
I'm not going back there. I don't care what you do. But Terry would probably appreciate not having them, so. Our message today, No Other Way, and Becky had the perfect lead into it. We're going to talk about 1 Corinthians chapter 13, commonly called the love chapter. I always think of music. Was that God? Okay. I always think of music when I think of love. Most everybody probably has an R song or some song that's very special to them. Let's see what the Beatles, Bruce, help me here. All You Need Is Love. Yeah. All you need is love. Da, 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 da. There was the Love Boat. Who doesn't remember that, right? At least all of us in that age range. What else? What other songs about love? There's tons of them. Love Me Tender. Love Me Tender. Oh, yeah. They go on. Yep. All the world need, what the world needs now is love, sweet love. Amen to that. That was written how long ago, and boy, even more true today. Love is, the scripture tells us, the most excellent way. Today we're going to break down what is love, what is the meaning of love, how do we get love confused with other things. I thought, you know, a simple four-letter word like love, everybody knows what love is. It has different levels of meaning according to who you're with and who you have affection for. But I thought, what better place to start than to go to good old Webster and see what Webster says about love. Now, you guys know how I feel about Webster because often I go there and I'm like, who wrote this stuff? I think Daniel Webster is spinning in his grave at some of the stuff that they've modified in his dictionary. Well, here's what Webster says, a little bit of a consolidated version about the simple term of love. The first description says that it's a strong affection arising out of a kinship or personal ties. Okay. Another description is maternal love for a child. We're going to go back and visit that. Another description is attraction based on sexual desire. We're really going to visit that one in a little bit. And clear down in the descriptions, number four, actually 4A in the online Webster Dictionary, says that love is the fatherly concern of God for humankind. Keep in mind, that was number 4A on the list of descriptions of love. Well, as Becky said, the Apostle Paul talked about love a lot. In this 13th chapter, it's filled with that's all it's about, is what is love, what do we do with it, what does it mean to us? And Paul certainly knew about love firsthand, didn't he? He was a guy who didn't exude any love, I'd have to say, early in his life, until he went down that road to Damascus. And I know several times we've talked about that lately, but if any of you have ever had a life-changing event, something that happens in your life that grabs your head and yanks it around the other way and makes you realize that maybe there's something different going on that you've never imagined, that maybe the direction that you're going is not the direction that you should be headed, then you understand the significance of Paul's experience on the road to Damascus. He was heading off to Damascus to go there once again, to jail as many people as he could, to maim and kill more Christians, whatever he could do to get the word, as he called it, the word of God. Jesus had been on around and he knew about it, and believe it or not, Paul got a hold of the powers that be in the cities ahead of when he got there and got their permission. Sure, you can come have all the Christians that you want. Paul was just so excited. He didn't know why he despised Jesus so. He just knew that he despised this word, and so he packed up and he's going down the road to Damascus. But as we all know, Paul had a significant experience on that road. He's trucking along with his buddies, can't wait to get there, and all of a sudden this blinding light, literally blinding, comes out of nowhere and blinded him. Remember the old days of cameras with flashes? everybody probably has had their picture taken with something with a flash, and it flashes in your eyes, and for a second you can't see a thing, and then you get maybe like little blue dots that float around for a while. Well, imagine, if you will, Paul has this blinding light that comes upon him, and it got his attention. Because it didn't just last a second, and he didn't get little blue dots floating around. He could no longer see. And Jesus took that opportunity, created that opportunity, to teach Paul a more excellent way, which was the way of love. And Paul learned his lesson well through the events that unfolded from that life-changing event. And he gives a lengthy but accurate account of the results of that in the first chapter, Corinthians 1, chapter 13. And it's lengthy, but we're going to read the whole thing. So if you've got your Bible there, want to grab your pew Bible and turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Here we go. And yet I will show you the most excellent way. If I speak in tongues of men or of angels, but do not have love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have faith that can move mountains, but I do not have love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and give over my body to hardship that I may boast, but I do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. It doesn't envy. It doesn't boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. I'd camp on that for a minute, but we got scripture ahead of us. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. But where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be stilled. Where there is knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part, but when completeness comes, what is in part will disappear. When I was a child, I talked like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put the ways of childhood behind me. For now, we see only a reflection in the mirror. Then we will see face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. And now these three remain: faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. This is the word of God for the people of God. Mr. Webster and his team of folks that put together the online dictionary seem to have a common misunderstanding of love. First of all, it's completely out of order. Amen. At least as Christians, we feel that it's completely out of order. Because if, as Scripture says, the greatest of these is love, then why does Webster have God's concern and love for us listed as number 4A? Should it not be first? Then his love, he has love and lust all mixed up. He talks in there, he gives a description that describes love as a sexual attraction for someone, but my friends, lust is not love. Now, you can be in love and lust for someone, and you cannot be in love and lust for someone, but lust and love don't go hand in hand together in any way. And then there's that one on maternal love for a child. The first thing I did was started looking through it over and over again, thinking, but where's the papa? Where's the paternal love for a child? Why does mom get top billing in this whole thing? We have some terrific dads on earth and a lot of dads that are raising kids lovingly on their own. So why does mom necessarily get top billing? Why don't we have a maternal and or paternal love for a child? First Corinthians is another one of Paul's letters. He had a lot of time to write as he went in and out of prison and had different maladies health-wise that slowed him down and stopped him. And this one, again, was going to a distant city, planting the seed before he got there. One thing that he knew about the city of Corinth as he wrote the letter was that the city was filled with greed and immorality, and Paul was trying to get their attention and make them pause and reconsider. He knew they needed to think that they had it all wrong, because you know how it is, if you think you got it all right and somebody shows up and says no, 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 you just put your fingers in your ears and close your eyes and go, because I don't want to hear that. I know the way that it is in my world, in my mind. Paul was trying to plant a seed so that they would be receptive to what he had to say. How is it that we don't understand what it is that Paul was trying to get through? Often today, just like in those days, we still struggle with the same issues that the people in Corinth were struggling with then. When we think about Webster's description of love and we look at some of those terms again, think of it this way. Lust is something that's directed towards our inward self, a self-satisfaction thing, while love is directed outward to others. Do you recall, when you think about it, any scripture where God projects love inward versus outward? No. God is always projecting love in an outward way. Why? Because God is love. And if we don't have that basic concept of that's what the world is all about and that's what Christianity is all about, then we need to go back to Genesis and start all over again. God is love. And as we look around at each other and we realize that we all have different gifts to give, some people have the gift of artistic talent, some people have the gift of musical talent, some people have the gift of building things, some people have the gift of hospitality. Stars in Fort Wayne right now picking up salad and bread and all the goodies so that we can have a wonderful free meal after church together. That's a gift of hospitality. And many of you have that as well. All of us have different gifts, but love is available to receive and to give to anyone, regardless of their social status, regardless of the gifts that they have or don't have, love is available. I was reading through some of my devotions this week, and one of my favorite ones, a lot of you are familiar with Jesus Calling, but there's a bunch of them in the series, and another one is this one called Jesus Today, and I don't remember if I've shared this one before, but it's more by topic rather than a daily devotion. There's 365 of them, but it's more by a topic. And listen to what this one had to say. I mean, I literally picked this up off my shelf today. It had been on there long enough that it was a little crunchy when I opened it, so I hadn't used it for a while. And I opened it up kind of almost to the middle there and went, oh my gosh, I think God's trying to tell me something. So I wanted to share it with you. And it says this, and remember that the author writes these in the first person as if Jesus or if God was speaking to you directly. And it says, I am the God of love and peace. Let the splendor of this glorious truth sink into the depths of your heart, mind, and spirit. The one who is always with you is the God of love and peace. When you feel a need for more love, come to me and let me lavish it upon you. Whenever you are feeling anxious or afraid, come into my peaceful presence and relax in the everlasting arms that are awaiting you. I want your character to reflect me more and more, so endeavor to be loving and peaceful in your relationships with other people. When someone irritates or upsets you, try to see me in that person. Remember that I created everyone in my own image. The most effective way to love people is to allow my love to flow through you to them. My spirit lives inside you, and you can ask him to love others through you. To live peacefully, you need to forgive people quickly. I needed to hear that again. Including yourself. Oh, including yourself. Make every effort to live close to me, the God of love and peace. I think I got a slide back there on 2 Corinthians 13:11. Let's just let that sit there and bake a little while. Not in our scripture for today, but just a really good lesson to study a little bit, jot down if you're a note taker and go back and pray over. Paul says love is patient. Can we all say uh-oh together? In fact, it's one of the very first lines after he says, I'm going to tell you a most excellent way. Love is patient. Must be something to it. If Webster screwed up the order of things, I doubt that Paul did. And I'm sure that it's never happened to you, but I have found myself irritated and angered by others at times. Evidently it hasn't. I was thinking that probably had never happened to you, that you were ever irritated and angry with someone else. Yeah. Go ahead and laugh out loud or fall on the floor crying. It's okay. I get it. And sometimes I don't know why I'm so irritated and angry with others. But I get that way sometimes for whatever reason. My poor husband's not here to defend himself. The guy's a saint, I'm telling you. And he'll say to me, did I do something wrong? No, why? Well, you just seem a little cranky, which might not be the right thing to say. And honestly, if I'm upset with him, I just tell him I'm upset with him. But the truth be known, usually I've got too much on my plate, too many things on my mind. I'm concerned or worried about someone or something, and I need to share that with him more. But sometimes I don't know why. And it's not always from a selfish motive that I'm upset or angry, but listen, to treat someone else with irritability is wrong under any circumstances. I wrote that note, and boy, I had to reread that several times and decide if I wanted to share that with you. But isn't it true? To treat someone else with irritability is wrong under any circumstances. And if you examine irritability, it often comes from the love of perfection. We've got an agenda and it's not going our way. It comes from a desire that everything would run perfectly in our world, or I'll say my world and let you guys off the hook. And that things would be in order without a hitch. My way or the highway. I know I've got this right. I've worked on this for a long time, and now everybody needs to get on board and row with me. And then when it doesn't go that way, I get irritable. I get cranky. Not that you ever do. But when things run off the rail and don't go according to plan, our anger often erupts. And so here's the deal. It probably would be really good to remember that if you easily anger, remember that the only perfection in the world exists in God, not in other people, not in programs, not in systems. The only perfection that there is God. And if you and I are God's perfect creations, you knew that, right? Says so in the big book several times. If we are his perfect creations, then who are we to be angered and irritable? Verse 5 in our scripture today. Love is not easily angered and keeps no record of wrongs. You guys all know I'm just a rabid Max Lucado fan, and I don't read him as much as I'd like to because that's all I would preach on a weekly basis. But in my bookshelf, when I pulled my little Jesus Today off, there was one of my vast collection of Lucado books, the one titled A Love Worth Giving, and I thought, well, that fits right in, gave me the excuse to pull that right off the shelf. And he had a great story in there about a 3-year-old who fell, we can probably almost all relate to this, fell down, smacked her head on the corner of a table, and blacked out right there on the floor. 3 years old, little person. Of course, the parents were there. They gathered her up. They rushed her to the hospital and found that it wasn't just a knock on the noggin. She had a skull fracture. It was a frightening thing. And for 3 days, when they got her home, she was just very, very quiet. Now, any of y'all that's ever had a 3-year-old around knows that if they're quiet, they're either up to something that you better find out pretty soon, or they're really sick, right? So for 3 days, this little girl was really quiet. But on the morning of the 4th day, when Daddy got up early and went down the hall to do your morning business, he heard her in her room, in her crib, and she was taking inventory of everything around her. And he heard her saying, bear, doggy, sheep, baby, and he smiled as he went by. As she went on then with her self-inventory, eyes, nose, ears, hair. She was checking out her world and to see if everything was in order. She was taking stock of her immediate surroundings and of herself, seeing if everything was in the right order, because for 3 days it hadn't been, and even at 3 years old, she certainly knew it. Friends, if we would take stock of those that are important to us and make a list, we would be reminded of their value. And I tell you, even the person that walks this earth that is the biggest irritant to you that you could have ever imagined that God would put in your path, there is some value to them in your life. And if you put them on that list and really thought about it and prayed about it, I guarantee you, you would identify something that would help you to understand why God put them in your mix in the walk of life. You might be one of those people that the world is a little too people-y out there. You'd rather be home, buried in your books, working in your garden, doing whatever your thing is, and you don't do the whole people thing, and that's completely understandable. But what else is more important than those that we love and care for? So even if you aren't a people-y person, there's times that you have to put that aside, putting self aside, and care for those that you love, even if your circle is small. Think about this. You know, we're all going to have final days in our lives. It's going to happen. And we may go out really quickly, and we may be in bed and linger a while or somewhere in between. But if you put yourself in the situation that you're laying on what we used to call your deathbed and your final days of your life, what will you want and who will you want there? Will you hug your framed college degree, or will you find comfort in rereading your financial reports that came recently? Of course not. What you're going to want and what will matter is who you love and who loves you. Love isn't always easy, is it? In fact, love can be one of the toughest things that we ever could have imagined. Sometimes it's obvious. Those that have been the source of heartache, abuse, rejection, or lonely to us, how in the world can we ever love people that have caused us such pain? And trust me, there's a lot of it out there. And a lot of times when people are busy in life and they go through and they push that aside, but even sometimes very late in life, that comes to the surface again and begins to define who they are. And this pain and this anger and this sorrow comes about. And you realize that you weren't treated fairly, and you didn't do anything to deserve it, but it happened. And what do you do with such pain? Well, there's a step that we often forget to take, and author Max Lucado brings it home. He said, maybe we are trying to give what we don't have. Are we forgetting or refusing to let our own love cup be filled so that it can overflow to others? And he goes on to say, does God love us because of our goodness and kindness and great faith? That's a question I'm asking you. Does God love us because of our goodness and kindness and great faith? No. He loves us regardless, even when we're rotten to the core. That's not the reason that he loves us. He loves us because of his goodness and kindness and great faith. Because we are his perfect creations. In Deuteronomy 7, verses 7 and 8, paraphrased, Moses says to the people of Israel, the Lord did not choose you and lavish his love on you because you were larger or greater than other nations, for you were the smallest of all nations. It was simply because the Lord loved you. No other reason. And love is an attribute of God himself. When Paul referred in verse 12, we shall see face to face, he's referring to our heavenly encounter with God, because you know we're all going to have one, right? When we meet face to face. So when we see God, we will see only pure love with no strings attached. Think on that a minute. Honestly, can you think of any love here on earth that there is no strings attached to it? I'm going to love you like nobody's ever loved you until you fill in the blank. Because that's human. And if we're hurt or we're scarred, there's going to be strings attached. Pure love when we see God. And then when we come to that point, we're also not going to see any differences in each other. No matter how good you've been, no matter how rotten your neighbor has been, God's not going to see any difference, and we're not going to see that difference in each other anymore. No more anger, agitation, or irritation, just simply love. Can you comprehend that? I can't. I can't in any way comprehend that. When it comes to that day, our differences will become a reason to praise God. I've said before and I'll say again, it would be a boring world, wouldn't it, if we all looked alike, acted alike, had the same interests, what have you. It'd be boring as all get out. But sometimes those differences also can drive us crazy about other people. Amen? But when we're there with God, our differences are going to become a reason to praise Him. We're going to praise that diversity and those differences. But wait and think about that for a minute. Could we maybe just maybe start to do a little bit of that right now? Here? On earth? We could. We could start by treating each other with the love and the unity that we will all share when we get to heaven. You can say, uh-oh, right now. Thank you. Friends, does your faith fully express itself in love to others? Or are you sitting defensively, arms folded in the judgment seat, waiting for the rest of the world to get it right for your world? What was the movie? Should have written it down. No, it wasn't Top Gun. It was, although that was a great movie. It was about a year or so ago, and it was the one where, it was from The Shack when they made that into the movie version. And I was interested in seeing the movie because I'd read the book, you know, and so often it's different. How many of you have seen the movie of The Shack? To me, and it's probably different for everyone, but the most impactful place in the whole movie was when they got to the judgment seat. And the angel sitting there got up, and it's not a spoiler alert because it's just part of the whole show, but the angel that was sitting there when the guy was objecting and throwing out all his, but you don't know how bad it was for me and you don't, and the angel got up, moved over quietly and offered him the judgment seat. You sit here. You take it. If you're so qualified, you make the judgments. I remember sitting there with tears welling up in my eyes and goosebumps the size of triple goosebumps on my arms, because that had a huge impact of how often that we do that. We want to sit in the judgment seat so that we can be in control of our world, but the reality is, what does God say about that? God says, that judgment seat doesn't fit your behind or my behind or any behind. That's made for one, and it isn't any of us. So ask yourself again, are you sitting defensively, arms folded in the judgment seat, waiting for the rest of the world to get it right in your world? If faith is your foundation in God, and hope is your attitude and focus, and love is a result of both, then it's a win-win all the way around. So if there's in all of that in Paul's scripture in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, in all of that, if there's only three things that remain, faith, hope, and love, and the greatest of these is, then what in the world are we waiting for? Let's pray. Father God, it's a big scripture and it's deep. And we hear it at weddings, and we hear it as a nicety, but Paul was driving home the fact that we had all the answers to that right in front of us, but we need to use them. Father, help us take this scripture this week and study it on our own and dive into it and figure out what it is you're trying to say to us. What is it that you want us to do? What is it in our lives that needs to change? What is it in our attitude that needs to change toward others and towards ourselves so that we can be more fully committed to your kingdom. We pray it in your precious and your holy name. Amen. Let's stand together and sing our closing song. Count your blessings.